down to Georgia. He was looking for a soul to steal. He was in a bind, but he was way behind. He was willing to make a deal. When he came across this young man, saw him on the field and playing it hot. And the devil jumped up on a hickory stump and said, "Boy, let me tell you what. I guess you didn't know it, but I'm a fiddle player too. And if you care to take a dare, I'll make a bet with you. Now you play pretty good fiddle, boy, but give the devil his due. I bet a fiddle of gold against your soul, because I think I'm better than you." And the boy said, "My name's Johnny, and it might be a sin, but I'll take your bet, you're going to regret, because I'm the best it's ever been. Johnny, rise up your bow and play your fiddle hard, because your focus in Georgia and the devil use it hard. And if you win, you get this shiny fiddle made of gold, but if you lose, the devil gets your soul."
All right, welcome back, A Push Scholars. Mr. Beamer here. We're going to finish up Chapter 22 with the Furnace of Civil War. We wanted to thank the Charlie Daniels Band with The Devil That Went Down to Georgia from the late 1970s. And Georgia's a big part of the end of the Civil War. We'll get to that later. Here are some key topics that we're going to cover today. All right, in our last video, we covered the war in the East, talking mostly about Gettysburg and Antietam, and now we're going to focus out to the West. And if we look at the map here, look at the key, some of the battles and places. The blue dots were the Union victories, and this reddish color were the Confederate victories. And if you look over here in the east, there was pretty even. We had some Confederate, some Union victories, and some were inconclusive. But out west, though, most of the battles were won by the Union. Okay, and we're really going to focus on one here along the Mississippi River, Vicksburg. Okay, so we talked about in A Push, you need to know the beginning war, the beginning battles, the turning points, and the last battle. And out west, the turning point battle is Vicksburg, so it's a must-know in A Push. Okay, and the general leading the Union forces was Ulysses S. Grant. He later becomes a president. He is the best general in the Union Army. And he was relentless with his troops. He was very aggressive, very forceful, always went into battle. Unlike General McClellan, who had the slows, Grant, he was very, very decisive in being aggressive. And so Grant wins many of the key battles in Tennessee and Mississippi. And like I mentioned earlier, the key battle you need to know is Vicksburg. And that happened on July 4th, 1863, basically the day after the Battle of Gettysburg was over. So those two major turning points happened basically in the early part of July of 1863. And I would highlight this. It's the turning point in the West. And the reason why is because it controlled the Mississippi River. Okay, we already controlled New Orleans, and now we definitely control the upper half of the Mississippi River, and so the South was definitely doomed after the Battle of Vicksburg in the West. All right, the next section relates completely with the song about being in Georgia, and so Sherman scorches Georgia. You need to know this general's name, General William Tecumseh Sherman. He is a Union general, and he leads a march through Georgia from Atlanta through the Carolinas, and this is called Sherman's March to the Sea. I would highlight this. I don't have the years on this, but this is the end of 1864 into early 1865. And the first thing he does is he captures and burns Atlanta, which was a key transportation hub in the South, and that actually helped Lincoln in the election of 1864 because he captured this city a few weeks before Lincoln's election, and that victory definitely helped give Lincoln some momentum. And Sherman used a tactic called total war. I would highlight this. And he basically destroyed everything. He set a path of destruction 1 mile wide, going from Atlanta to the Atlantic Ocean, and destroyed everything. Cut up railroad tracks, burned fields and crops, destroyed property, everything in their path. And this is called total war, basically bringing the war not just to the soldiers, but to civilians as well. And this basically sunk the morale of the South, and it really punishes the South for starting the war. Again, here's the battle map of the Civil War, and this is going to show, again, Atlanta, and then Sherman's direction towards the sea, eventually ending up in Savannah, and then heading up towards South Carolina. All right, so politics plays a huge part during the Civil War, and we know that the Republicans did control much of the country's political arena during the Civil War. And during the war, a group called the Congressional Committee on the Conduct of War was created in 1861, and these were dominated by the radical Republicans. And so we know that Lincoln was a Republican, we know that, but the radicals were even more against slavery than Lincoln. A lot of these were major abolitionists. We know Lincoln was against slavery, but these radicals wanted complete emancipation, and they wanted to punish the white South. So that was one side giving Lincoln some troubles. The other side on the political spectrum were the Democrats. And some Northern Democrats, we know that they did split during the election of 1860, and then Stephen Douglas dies early during the Civil War, and the Democrats split even more into two groups, the War Democrats, and these are the people that supported Lincoln, and then many Democrats were against him, and they did not support him. These were called the Peace Democrats. You're going to have to know these two different groups, and so Lincoln's kind of in the middle between the Radical Republicans, who want to punish the White South, and the Peace Democrats, who want to be more forgiving to the White South. And probably the worst group, or the ones that gave Lincoln the most trouble, were the Copperheads, kind of a reference to the snake. And these ones were totally against the war, and they were very against Lincoln and gave him many problems during the Civil War. Okay, and this chart should hopefully give you a little bit of understanding of the political situation during the Civil War. So we got the Republicans, and again, Lincoln was a Republican, but even some of the radicals were not extremely happy with Lincoln. But he did have the biggest problem with the Democrats. And so the War Democrats actually did support Lincoln, but two-thirds of the Democrats were against him. The Peace Democrats wanted to end the war soon, and the Copperheads definitely wanted to end the war, and they were more supportive of the white Southerners, and they despised Lincoln. And some of these Copperheads, they branded Lincoln Abraham Africanus I, talking about how he was too nice to African Americans and to the slaves. So this document here is anti-propaganda against Lincoln created by the Copperheads. So now we'll get into the election of 1864, and it was Lincoln running again as a Republican, and he did get support from the War Democrats. And during this election, Lincoln actually forms the Union Party. Okay, so this party is Lincoln's official political party during this election, but it's pretty much made up of Republicans and some War Democrats. And the Copperheads and the Peace Democrats, they do have their own Democratic candidate, and that's George McClellan, and we know that he was one of Lincoln's biggest enemies during the war. He did not attack with his soldiers very quickly, and him and Lincoln really butted heads quite often. So the Union Party, again, mostly Republicans and some more Democrats, they decide to choose Democrat Andrew Johnson as the vice president. Now, Andrew Johnson was from Tennessee, so he was one of the few people from the South that actually supported the Union during the war. So this is his VP, and the thinking is that Andrew Johnson would get some Democratic supporters to vote for Lincoln. So again, like most elections in American history, there's a lot of mudslinging, negative talk, negative propaganda against both sides. The popular vote was relatively close. Lincoln only won by 400,000 votes over McClellan. However, the Electoral College was clearly in Lincoln's favor, 212 to 21. And you don't have to memorize these numbers, but I would know that Lincoln did win a pretty decisive election, and partly because of Sherman's march to the sea. When Sherman captures Atlanta, it gives Lincoln a lot of support to get reelected. All right, I love documents. This guy you need to know, Thomas Nass, is probably the most famous cartoonist, political cartoonist in A Push. And he has a lot of his political cartoons in the late 1800s during the Gilded Age. A lot of it is going to be against the political machines, and especially Boss Tweed, who was part of the Tammany Hall political machine in New York City. But this document created by Thomas Nast in 1864 is talking about the Chicago platform, and he's basically trying to criticize the Democrats here. Okay, so this is an anti-Democrat cartoon in talking about the election or their candidate, George McClellan. And if you look at it, there's not a lot of positives in here, especially look over here. Okay, so Thomas Nast is kind of saying that Democrats support slave auctions here, the brutal treatment of slaves as well. So this was designed to get support for Lincoln against the Democrats. Okay, the next section is the end of the war. Grant outlasts Lee. And so in spring of 1854, Grant is brought to the Eastern Front by Lincoln. Lincoln's like, this is my best general. I want him to fight against Robert E. Lee. So Grant leaves the West and comes to Virginia. And like we mentioned earlier, he is relentless with his forces, very aggressive. And an example of that, in one battle, thousands die in minutes of a battle that Grant said, we are going to attack with everything we have during this battle. And this battle was called Cold Harbor in Virginia, and thousands died. 7,000 men were killed or wounded within the first few minutes of this battle. And the point of it, it shows that Grant was going to be very aggressive with his soldiers to help win the war as soon as possible. All right, so moving on then to 1865, the final year of the war, Grant eventually does capture the capital of Richmond, but the problem is the Confederate Army is still out, and so Grant has to capture Lee's forces and force him to surrender, and he does. At Appomattox Courthouse in April of 1865, April 9, 1865, I would highlight this year, that is the last day of the Civil War, and the Union wins, and so the war starts in Virginia at Bull Run and it ends at Appomattox Courthouse. Okay, now I get to talk about the martyrdom of Lincoln and one of the saddest days in American history. Abraham Lincoln was assassinated by John Wilkes Booth on April 14, 1865, 5 days after the Appomattox Courthouse surrender by the South. Actually, Lincoln does die the next day, so his official death is on April 15th. He dies in the morning. He's shot in the head at Ford's Theater in Washington, D.C. And so it's one of the saddest days. The South, unfortunately, was quite happy at first because Lincoln was the tyrant and their biggest nemesis, according to them. But later, especially during the next time period called Reconstruction, many Southerners realized that Lincoln probably would have treated him better than some of the radical Republicans in Congress after the Civil War. The last section is the aftermath of the nightmare. And so the Civil War cost at least 600,000 men, close to a million if you count the casualties as well, those that were wounded. And it was a $15 billion war. So it was just a very costly war. It was a nightmare, probably the worst event in American history. However, there were some positives to it because it does end slavery. And so again, it's such an awful war, but slavery does end, which is awesome. I'd write this down that the 13th Amendment was created and eventually ratified by all the states at the end of 1865. So the 13th Amendment ends slavery in America. And so Lincoln is not alive to see the final ratification by the states, but he was alive when it was passed in both houses of Congress. So the Civil War gave America the supreme test of its existence, so we can survive one of the worst possible events of a country, a civil war, and we did show that we are strong and that we are destined to be this great country that we are today. And so the last thing I want to leave you with is the Civil War made the United States was instead of the United States were. Okay, so what this means, think about it, the United States was one country now instead of a country made up of several states. So we're united because of the Civil War and the leadership of the greatest president in American history, Abraham Lincoln. But unfortunately, Lincoln does die, and so now we got to figure out what are we going to do, how are we going to bring the South back into the Union, and that's going to be another nightmare for our country, and that time period is called Reconstruction, and we'll get to that in the next chapter.